Hi everyone, this is the respiratory diseases lecture. Here you're going to learn about different respiratory diseases. There are a ton of different respiratory diseases, but I tried to focus on ones that are very common. So if you're reading the textbook, they talk about pertussis and diphtheria. So I skipped some of those. And what you're going to learn about in this lecture are the common cold, flu, streptococcal, pharyngitis, which is strep throat, tuberculosis, influenza. And then I added COVID-19 because it is a respiratory disease. And with each of the diseases, we're going to cover etiology, which is the cause of a disease, epidemiology, pathogenesis, how it spreads, symptoms of the disease, treatment, prevention, and possible complications from getting infected with any of these things. So to start off with some definitions, incubation period, I think a lot of you guys have been hearing this in the news with everything going on. So the definition of incubation period is how long it takes to show symptoms. So from the moment you're infected until you show symptoms. An example of that would be like, if someone has COVID-19 and they sneeze on me and I breathe it in, how long does it take to show symptoms? Like, I'm not gonna show symptoms a minute later or an hour later with COVID-19. With COVID-19, it takes about, on average, 5 days to show symptoms. So that's what we mean when we say incubation period. So if we would take me as an example and it takes me 5 days to show symptoms, in those 5 days of that incubation period, the patient is asymptomatic. So maybe right now someone sneezes on me and tomorrow and the day after I'm fine, I'm not showing any symptoms, but I'm still carrying the virus and I'm still contagious. So keep that in mind. And with every pathogen, the incubation period is different. So it's different for every single disease. But if I gave some examples of some infections, like the flu, its incubation period is 1 to 3 days. If you encounter the influenza virus, it'll take you about 1 to 3 days to show symptoms. With tuberculosis, which is a bad lung infection, it takes weeks, even months. So maybe someone has tuberculosis and you get it through close contact. You may not show symptoms for a month, but you still carry the bacteria. And then with AIDS, it's 1 to 10 years. So from the moment you get HIV, which is the virus, until you show symptoms of the disease AIDS, it takes a very long time. So that's what incubation period is. And the just, you guys know, you guys are microbiologists now after taking this class. Incubation comes from the word like incubating the microbe. That's where we get that from. And another term I want you to know before we talk about respiratory diseases is infectious dose or ID. Infectious dose is the smallest number of pathogens required to cause disease. So if every disease has a different infectious dose. So for example, measles, it takes one virus to give you measles. 10 viruses will also give you measles, but it only takes one for you to get the disease. So that's the infectious dose. So this has a very low infectious dose. The lower an infectious dose is for a disease, the more virulent the disease is. It means that the pathogen is very potent or very strong and you only need a little bit of it. So I was trying to look up what the infectious dose is for COVID-19. And so the virus that causes it, SARS-CoV-2, I was looking it up last night and I couldn't find any information about how many viruses you need to actually cause COVID-19 because it's relatively new. But some of the articles were saying they just suspect it's low because it's easily transmitted. So unfortunately, I couldn't get that information. But like, okay, for example, cholera. Cholera is a bad diarrhea disease that's caused by bacteria. You need about 100 million cells to get cholera. So you need a high amount of ingested bacteria to get cholera. If you just ingest a little bit, then you're not going to get the disease. So that's what infectious dose is. And this is also important for scientists who run experiments in lab when they do different experiments on like animals to know how much of the microbe to inject them with if you're trying to like track a disease or do anything with the animals. So now we're going to get into respiratory tract infections. There are many different infections. There's skin infections, urinary tract infections, digestive infections. Respiratory tract infections are the most common infections, and it's the most common infections because we're all always breathing. So these are infections that have to do with airborne pathogens that are taken in when you breathe or you're in close contact with someone who coughs or sneezes, or you touch them and then you touch your nose, mouth, or even eyes. So that's what respiratory tract infections are. Anything that has to do with breathing, basically. And remember, breathing has to do with your nose, mouth, and lungs, if we were to summarize it up. So there are many respiratory tract infections, and they range from super mild to very fatal or severe. Like you can imagine, I would classify a common cold as very mild, and then tuberculosis as a pretty strong disease. And these infections are divided into upper respiratory tract infections and lower respiratory tract infections. Upper respiratory tract infections have to do with infections that basically affect your upper respiratory tract. So this area, this is like when you're really congested, so nose, mouth. Lower respiratory tract infections are things that basically affect your lungs. And remember that many infections can start off as only upper respiratory tract infections and remain upper respiratory tract infections in some people. And then in other people, they can turn into lower respiratory tract infections and infect lungs. But these are lower respiratory tract infections are usually the more serious ones that can be fatal. And this is, again, here's a picture of respiratory system, just very simple. So you have your nose, mouth, voice here. This area is upper respiratory tract, and then anything that's going lower, getting to the lungs, is a lower respiratory tract infection. The respiratory system, I don't want to get really into the physiology of it because it's a microbiology class, but just to summarize it, it's basically for breathing. So it's the system that has to do with taking in oxygen and breathing out CO2 or carbon dioxide. Your vocal cords function in sounds, your nose functions for odors, and eyes and ears are associated with ducts or openings that lead to the nasal cavity and throat. So now we're going to talk about the anatomy very briefly of each. With the upper respiratory tract, this has to do with the nose, the pharynx. Pharynx is just throat, so they mean the same thing. Middle ear, Eustachian tubes, which mean auditory tubes, they're the same thing, and epiglottis. Epiglottis is the little flap that makes sure that food doesn't go down the wrong pipe, because you have one for breathing and one for eating. And with all of, so these are the main organs of the upper respiratory tract. So they have to do with this area up, the upper area. And there's defense mechanisms in this area to protect you against being infected. So your upper respiratory tract is lined by mucous membranes. There's something called goblet cells. A lot of you have already taken anatomy, so you learned about goblet cells. So goblet cells produce glycoprotein, and glycoprotein is this sticky protein. It's a sugar protein. You guys all know sugar is sticky, and what it does is it traps pathogens so that they don't go even deeper. And then we have already learned that there is IgA antibody in different secretions, such as your saliva and your tears, which protect your eyes. Wax protects your external ear. That's why you're not supposed to, if some of you did not know this, you're really not supposed to be removing the wax from your ears. It's supposed to be an evolutionary thing that's developed to protect us. And then tonsils are lymphoid organs, meaning they carry lymph, which has white blood cells that help with infection that we've learned about. And then there's your normal microbiota in your mouth, in your nose, that protects you from pathogens. So this is upper respiratory tract. And then the lower respiratory tract has to do with your larynx or your voice box. So when you have an inflammation of your larynx, that's when you lose your voice. Trachea is your windpipe. And then that leads to your bronchial tubes here and alveoli, which are the little sacs at the end that have to do with gas exchange. So O2 for CO2. So this is lower respiratory tract. So again, it's larynx, trachea, bronchial tubes, alveoli. Basically, bronchial tubes and alveoli are lungs. And the defense mechanisms here, because we really want your lower respiratory tract area to stay sterile, especially your lungs, you have the mucociliary escalator. And remember, we learned about that. What it does is there's cilia on these cells. Cilia are little hairs, and they have mucus. And what they do is you trap the pathogens and thus in the mucus, and then you sweep it away so that it doesn't get deep down into your lungs. And again, this ciliary escalator, it can be affected by smoking, alcohol, drug abuse, viral infections. This affects all respiratory tract infections, but because of COVID-19, I really do want to stress that with COVID-19, as you have all seen, there's been a range of cases from super mild to fatal, deadly cases. And regardless of genetics and everything else, just know that smoking really does make, if you do get infected with the virus, makes getting COVID-19 way worse. I've had people ask me about vaping and smoking, and it does really affect it because this is affecting your ciliary escalator. So if you do smoke, it's a good time probably to stop with everything going on. And then we also have macrophages or white blood cells that do phagocytosis in the alveoli, and they're there to destroy any microbes that get in the lungs. There's a lot of macrophages there. And then mucus in your different respiratory cells. And again, keep in mind, we do not have normal microbiota here to protect us because lungs should be sterile, unlike the upper respiratory tract where you have a lot of neutral and good bacteria in your nose and mouth to protect you from pathogens. And then there's many diseases of the respiratory system. We already talked about this early on in class before, but anytime you add itis to something, it means inflammation. So gastritis is inflammation of the stomach, and inflammation usually causes some sort of tissue damage. A disease of the respiratory system is rhinitis. This is nose inflammation. We've all had rhinitis when we've had a cold or a flu. Pharyngitis is when you have a sore throat or throat inflammation. Epiglottitis is when you have your epiglottis inflamed. And remember, this is a little covering that covers the lower respiratory tract when you swallow. So if this gets infected, it's very life-threatening because a person basically chokes here. Laryngitis is when your vocal cords are inflamed. So if you get a flu or a cold, it's rare, but if you do lose your voice, that's laryngitis. Tonsillitis is when your tonsils are inflamed. Sinusitis is when your sinuses are inflamed. Remember, sinuses are openings or cavities or spaces in your skull, and this is when people say they have sinus infections, typically what they mean, and it can cause headaches. Otitis is ear inflammation because otitis media is your middle ear. We'll learn about that later. And then pneumonitis is lung inflammation. I want to differentiate between pneumonitis and pneumonia. Remember, itis just means inflammation. So pneumonitis is when the lung is inflamed. Pneumonia is specifically when the lung is inflamed, leading to alveoli filling with fluid. So when you guys hear with pneumonia, that lungs fill with fluid, that's what it is. So we're going to focus now on upper respiratory tract infections. So I'm going to teach you about the common cold and strep throat. Again, there's many different upper respiratory tract infections, but these are the two we're going to talk about. And then later we'll talk about lower respiratory tract infections. I'm going to start off with the common cold. The common cold is the most frequent infectious disease in humans. It's very common. That's why it's called the common cold. And it's responsible for over half of upper respiratory tract infections. The cause of common colds, the etiology, that's what that means. The cause of common colds are viruses. There's many different viruses. I can't tell you about one virus that causes colds. They're the most common types of viruses that cause colds are rhinoviruses. When you think rhino or rhinitis, if you think rhinoceros, they have big noses. That's why these are called rhinoviruses, because they affect that area and you get very big swollen noses. There's over 100 types of different rhinoviruses. other viruses can cause common colds. Lots of coronaviruses cause common colds. I'm not talking about SARS-CoV-2 right now. Coronaviruses are a big family of viruses, and we'll learn about it later. But in that family of viruses, there's viruses that cause the common cold, adenoviruses, many, many other viruses that cause colds, but mainly rhinoviruses. And when we look at the epidemiology of common colds, it's seasonal. We see different colds in different seasons, maybe in one season. Typically in colder seasons, we see that it's more common to have colds, but it can depend because, again, there's so many viruses that cause common colds. Humans are the only source of these viruses, and these viruses spread by close contact. So they're droplets. I want to differentiate droplets and airborne, especially with everything going on in the news. A droplet disease means that someone basically sneezes and then it's in a little drop, like in their saliva, and it's in the air. Airborne is something completely different. Airborne is just in the air. So with a lot of respiratory tract, we're talking about droplet diseases, and they're in the air because of the droplets. But these aren't the diseases where, for example, you would avoid opening the window. You definitely would open the window because the droplets would have diluted so much. So just keep that in mind. And transmission for the common cold is, again, through close contact. And typically with these infections, during the beginning of the infection, the virus concentration is very high in the nose. So people are really very contagious. You guys know this. When someone has a cold, they're typically very contagious in the beginning. And you only need a few viruses to infect. Here's a nice graph that shows different viruses, common cold viruses, and when they peak in different months. So that's why it's not like we see that maybe just in winter. You see them year round with different viruses. When we look at the pathogenesis of cold viruses, pathogenesis means how does a virus cause disease. Remember when we learned about mechanisms of pathogenesis in a lecture before or two times before? We said that for something to cause disease, it needs to stick, it needs to get in, it needs to make copies of itself, it needs to damage the host, it needs to avoid host defenses. So with cold viruses, they infect epithelial cells, which are basically the top cells of upper respiratory tract. And this causes the ciliary motion of these infected cells to stop. Remember, the cilia on our cells is really good because it's trying to sweep up the microbes. So these cells die, and this damage leads to release of pro-inflammatory cytokines, such as histamine. So you get bad inflammation. This is where you see the swelling, the nasal secretions, sneezing, and the infection can spread to ears, sinuses, and the lower respiratory tract. It's eventually stopped by the immune system. So that's how a common cold functions. I put this image here. It's a pretty complicated image from a science paper, but I want you guys to get used to seeing these images that right now it's probably very hard to read, but you guys have the lecture notes. Anyway, what these images show is scientists, after a lot of studying, put these images together that show you. So here is human rhinovirus, and it's infecting a host epithelial cells. And it shows you what happens when the bacteria is in our cells. So it releases its genetic material. It makes copies of its genetic material. And then your body reacts by making different types of white blood cells, interferons, interleukins, cytokines, all of these things to try to fight off the infection. Signs and symptoms of colds. Most of you already know these. It's nasal secretion, so runny nose, congestion, sneezing. A common cold can lead to inflammation of your voice box called laryngitis, and it can lead to an ear infection called otitis media. I want everyone to keep in mind that with colds, there is no fever unless there is usually a secondary bacterial infection. So colds, typically we see very low or no fever. Treatment, there is no treatment for common colds. No one has effectively created any treatment yet. It's self-limiting within 1 week. Usually your immune system fights it off and you're okay within 1 week, depending on your health. But for most people, they're fine because you're all the good white blood cells and the cytokines fight it off. Their viruses, again, are not affected by antibiotics, so antibiotics do nothing for a common cold. Sometimes people will get relief by taking painkillers, and antipyretics are fever reducers, but just keep in mind that even though these things offer relief, they can prolong symptoms and they can prolong their duration. Like, for example, if you take antihistamines, like if you're having a really bad runny nose and secretions and all this stuff and you want to calm down the inflammation and you take antihistamines, you will feel better. It's just not a treatment, because also by knocking down the inflammation, you are a tiny bit dampening your immune system. So keep that in mind. Prevention of common colds, they spread so quickly, so the best way to prevent them is exactly what we're doing right now with COVID-19. Hand washing, don't touch your things, don't touch face, eyes, anything on your face, avoid crowded places and infected individuals. So exactly what we're doing, wear a mask if you don't want to infect others. And right now, as you all know, with cold, we don't have a vaccine. We don't even have people working on a vaccine because there's so many viruses. Like, where would you start for creating a vaccine for a common cold? So that's common colds. Possible complications. Complications are rare, but they can happen of a common cold is when you have a cold, you're immunocompromised. So we've all been immunocompromised at one point in our life. You can get other infections. So secondary bacterial infections are very common with colds, especially sinus infections and ear infections. So otitis media is infection of the middle ear. And in the middle ear, you get a lot of white blood cells and pressure on the eardrum from all the inflammation. So it can be very painful. And we see ear infection or otitis media common in children because they have a small eustachian tube or auditory tube in comparison to adults. So that's why if anyone has kids, you know that ear infections are very common, especially after cold. So it comes as a secondary infection. And to sum up common colds, signs and symptoms are runny nose, sneezing, coughing, rarely a fever. So no fever. Incubation period is 1 to 2 days. They're caused by viruses, mainly rhinoviruses, some coronaviruses, adenoviruses. Pathogenesis are the viruses attached to respiratory epithelial cells in the upper respiratory tract. And the ciliary action stops, the cells slough off, they die, and you get a lot of inflammation and a lot of mucus. Epidemiology with these, they're seasonal and transmission is through inhalation. Treatment and prevention, there is no treatment. Prevention is by hand washing and avoiding crowded places, cleaning surfaces, all of that. Now for our next upper respiratory tract infections, we're going to talk about strep throat. Strep throat in the medical world is called streptococcal pharyngitis. So streptococcal comes from the bacteria that causes it. Pharyngitis means inflammation of the pharynx. Pharynx means throat. So normally people call it strep throat, but again, in medicine, this is called streptococcal pharyngitis. The cause of strep throat or streptococcal pharyngitis, the etiology is group A Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria, or GAS. These are gram-positive bacteria. They're caucus-shaped from the name, and they grow and change. So strepto, remember from the very beginning of the class, we said that strepto means chains, caucus are round. So you can easily identify these under the microscope because they're gram positive, they grow in chains, they're caucus shaped. If you grow them on blood agar, if you streak them on blood agar as a lab experiment, you get beta hemolysis. Beta hemolysis is when you see complete clearing where the bacteria grew. So the bacteria lyse all the red blood cells there, and that's basically what they're doing in your throat. The bacteria have enzymes called streptokinases that make them lyse blood clots, and strepto lesions, which basically kill erythrocytes and leukocytes, which are red blood cells and white blood cells. And all of this causes so much inflammation. These bacteria, the group A Streptococcus pyogenes, are also resistant to phagocytosis. So the strep throats are nasty infections. Epidemiology, group A strep bacteria, we see it seasonally, typically in colder months, and they naturally only infect humans. They're spread by droplets or contaminated food. There's a lot of people who have this bacteria in their nose and they're carriers, but they can spread it to other people. So they're asymptomatic. And a lot of these individuals are like in lab, if we were to take throat samples and we spread them on blood agar, I always have a student that feels very healthy, but then we see beta hemolysis. So we would consider that person a potential healthy carrier. Pathogenesis with the group A Streptococcus pyogenes bacteria. First, they have to adhere to the upper respiratory tract cells, the epithelia, and then they get in, the bacteria get in, and they do a lot of things. They mainly activate inflammation and they release toxins and they make your immune system overreact. So all the inflammation is what causes all the pain. So if we look at a normal throat, here's a sore throat. With strep throat, we see pus or white blood cells. So a lot of white blood cell accumulation in high amounts. Treatment, it is a bacterial infection. So if someone does have strep throat, we give antibiotics. Penicillin is very common because if you guys remember when we learned about antibiotics, penicillin is very effective with gram-positive bacteria. Streptococcus is a gram-positive bacteria. So penicillin targets the cell wall of these bacteria. Prevention is stop spreading these through the droplets. So if you know someone is sick, stay away from them. Do not eat by the same food, do not eat using the same utensils, don't be close to them, wash your hands, sharing food, kissing, all of these things. So it's the same prevention measures that we are doing with like the common cold. And there is currently no vaccine for strep throat. So if someone does get infected, they usually just take a dose of antibiotics. There are major complications that can happen because of a strep throat infection, streptococcal infection. You can get a secondary infection. You can get a sinus infection. You can get an ear infection. You can get scarlet fever. This one, it's not common. It's rare, but there's something called post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So if someone has a strep throat, all the inflammation can lead to damage to their kidneys because you get all these complexes being formed. If you guys remember that lecture when we talked about immune disorders, you get these immune complexes that form because the body is trying to fight the streptococcal infection. And these complexes sit on the glomeruli and they start killing these cells, basically. So you got a lot of inflammation here. This can also lead to rheumatic fever, which is joint pain, fever, chest pain. And then there's something called PANS. So this is an autoimmune disorder that is basically a neural disorder. It's like rheumatic fever of the brain, and it affects kids. It can lead to seizures. It can lead to someone being completely passed out. So just know someone can have strep throat, and that can easily turn to spread to rheumatic fever, heart infections, skin rashes, scarlet fever, and nervous system disorders such as PANS. So we talked about now upper respiratory tract infections. I talked about common colds and strep throat. With common colds, again, to summarize, they're caused by rhinoviruses. With strep throat, it's caused by bacteria, streptococcal pyogenes group A. So keep that in mind. Now we're gonna talk about a few lower respiratory tract infections, and I'm gonna cover pneumonia, tuberculosis, influenza, and then different fatal coronaviruses. So we'll start off with pneumonia. Pneumonia is a disease of the lower respiratory tract. It affects lungs, and what happens is the alveoli of the lungs, which are the little sacs at the end of the lungs. So here at the end of your bronchial, you have these alveoli. They fill with fluid, and that's what pneumonia is. It is a major inflammation response to a microbial infection, and this is the leading cause of death due to infectious disease in the U.S. So someone will come in with one infection and then quickly get another infection that potentially causes pneumonia. But to summarize it, it's when your alveoli fill with fluid or your lungs fill with fluid, and you can see it through an x-ray. And this shadow here is what we're seeing, not this. This here is your heart. What causes pneumonia? Pneumonia can be caused by so many different things. There is bacterial pneumonia. There is viral pneumonia. SARS-CoV-2 can cause pneumonia, so just keep that in mind. But we're going to focus on bacterial pneumonias, but just know that pneumonia can be caused by any infection. Anything that causes the lungs to fill with fluid is considered pneumonia. Some common bacteria that cause pneumonia are Streptococcus pneumoniae. This is a gram-positive coccus, and it causes pneumococcal pneumonia, and it's very common. And then there's Mycoplasma pneumoniae, which is a little bit less common, and it causes walking pneumonia. Many other bacteria, again, some Klebsiella species of bacteria cause pneumonia. Different viruses, different fungus. Here's a picture of Streptococcus pneumoniae, which is a cause of pneumococcal pneumonia. And these bacteria have a capsule. If you guys remember, bacteria that have a capsule are very hard to treat. The epidemiology, when we look at pneumonia, we can classify them as community-acquired pneumonia or healthcare-associated pneumonia. Community-acquired pneumonia are pretty contagious, and we see them usually from the patient's own microbiota, and it's when the microbiota went into the wrong spot in the lungs. Hospital-acquired pneumonias can also arise from normal microbiota, specifically when someone is immunocompromised, and ventilators really increase the risk of getting pneumonia. This is a disease of immunocompromised individuals, so pneumonia is very common in people whose immune system is compromised. Basically, people in the hospital are all immunocompromised. That's why pneumonia is very common there. Often, older people, this is very common with like grandparents. We see pneumonias a lot. Young children, smoking can cause pneumonia, any immunodeficiency disorder. Influenza, you can start off with influenza and then get it as a complication. Poverty and stress are common. So anything that leads to immunocompromise can lead to more pneumonias. There's a lot of asymptomatic carriers of pneumonia. Pathogenesis. So again, pneumonia, it just means that your lungs fill with fluid. It can be caused by a lot of things. So if we're talking about the bacteria that cause pneumonia, often bacteria that cause pneumonia have capsules. So the Streptococcus that causes pneumonia have capsules. And the capsules make phagocytosis really slow because it's harder for those white blood cells, the macrophages, to see that there are bacteria. The capsule kind of protects the bacteria. And this makes it very hard for your immune system to fight it. So that's why Streptococcus pneumoniae bacteria are very virulent. And then you get so much inflammation because the body is trying to fight off this infection. So this is what it's the inflammation that brings in the fluid. That it's kind of like your body's trying to fight it, but your body's also hurting yourself. So the alveoli of the lung fill with fluids and white blood cells and red blood cells, and this makes it very hard to breathe. Signs and symptoms of pneumonia are difficulty breathing, coughing, low fever, chest pain, but mainly chest pain, coughing, difficulty breathing. And sometimes when the pneumonia is very bad, you can see in the cough, you can see pus and blood that's coming up from the lungs. So this means that the pneumonia has become pretty significant. You can look at a sample of sputum, which is basically saliva or spit from someone, and you can look to see if you can see bacteria in it. You can also, doctors can use stethoscopes to hear any sounds when someone's breathing, showing that they're not breathing effectively. And white shadows on chest x-rays here. This is a really bad case of pneumonia in this picture. treatment. If it is a bacterial pneumonia or a fungal pneumonia, there is different antibiotics that can be used. For viral pneumonias, we do not have any effective treatment. Like if you get pneumonia from SARS-CoV-2, you cannot take antibiotics. It's a viral pneumonia. A lot of that healthcare associated pneumonias are caused by drug resistant bacteria. So these are very hard to treat. We do currently have a vaccine for pneumococcal disease. Again, pneumococcal pneumonia is caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae. So there is a vaccine for that. And if you guys remember anything about the vaccine lecture, this specifically is a polysaccharide vaccine. So they take the sugars from the bacteria Streptococcus pneumoniae and they use that as a vaccine to initiate an immune response from you so that if you ever are exposed to the bacteria, you hopefully do not get pneumococcal pneumonia. And prevention is avoid crowds and other respiratory illnesses that could potentially make you more at risk for getting pneumonia. Possible complications. So if you do get infected by any bug that causes pneumonia, it can lead to permanent lung damage if your body doesn't fight it off efficiently, and if you get so much inflammation. Also, if the bug, the microbe, whether that's bacteria or fungus or viruses, if they spread to other organs, you can get bacteremia, you can get bacteria in the blood. So it can be very bad and it can lead to death if it's not treated properly, I would say, and caught on quickly before your immune system can fight it. Here's a summary of pneumonia bacteria. Again, pneumonia can be caused by a lot of other things other than bacteria. If we focus on pneumococcal pneumonia, this one is caused by Streptococcus pneumonia. To summarize it, it takes about 1 to 3 days for you to see symptoms if you are infected with this bacteria. What these bacteria do is they colonize the alveoli, but they're encapsulated, so it's hard for your immune system to see them. And treatment is through antibiotics because it is bacterial prevention. There is a vaccine for it. Now we're going to talk about tuberculosis. Tuberculosis is another lower respiratory tract infection. It's a type of lung infection as well. It used to be very common. It still is common, but it used to be a lot more common. We've seen the incidence decline. So new cases decline in industrialized nations because of more hygiene and better living standards. The etiology, tuberculosis, unlike pneumonia, we can limit it to one thing. It's caused by bacteria called Mycobacterium tuberculosis. These are rod-shaped and they're acid-fast bacteria. So they're not bacteria that we would do a Gram stain with. If anyone remembers anything from lab, we would do an acid-fast stain with them. And so this is how you know that someone has tuberculosis. You do an acid-fast stain from a sample and you try to look for rods, which are Mycobacterium tuberculosis. These bacteria are obligate aerobes, so living in the lungs is great for them because they need oxygen. They grow extremely slow. Their generation time is 16 hours. Generation time is when one bacteria becomes two bacteria. It's not the time until you see it on an agar plate. So remember, they're microscopic. We can't see them. By the time you see a colony on an agar plate, there's millions of bacteria in there. So it takes about 25 days to culture these bacteria. So if you were to streak it in lab, you stick it in the incubator for about a month until you can do any experiments with them. And whether you're growing it in lab or it's an infection, just know they grow really slow. So typically someone will be infected but not showing a lot of symptoms yet, but they're still infected. It's just hasn't grown a lot yet. These bacteria have lipids called mycolic acid in their cell wall, so they make them very resistant to different antibiotics and different mechanisms we can use to treat them. Epidemiology, it's estimated that about a third of the world is infected, but only approximately a third of the world is a huge number, but there are infections that are not active. Keep that in mind. Only about 5 to 10% will reactivate and progress to active tuberculosis, and transmission is through the respiratory tract. The infectious dose for tuberculosis is very low. You only need about 10 bacteria to get the infection, so keep that in mind. There's something called latent tuberculosis and active tuberculosis. Latent tuberculosis is when you do have the bacteria, but they're not growing, they're not multiplying. Active is when they're spreading, so you have a high load of the bacteria. Active disease is very common with immunocompromised people. If you ever hear, a lot of times, a lot of patients that pass away from having AIDS, it's due to having a secondary infection. Tuberculosis is very common with AIDS patients. And with tuberculosis, we are seeing a lot of resistant bugs on the rise. The Mycobacterium tuberculosis is becoming resistant to so many drugs. So there's multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis and extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis. This extensive drug-resistant TB is resistant to almost every antibiotic we have. So it is a big, serious issue that we have. And there is not a lot of active research done on the field, because I told you guys that it's very slow to grow. So companies don't see this as a very fast field. It takes a really long time to grow the bacteria. Pathogenesis, just to summarize it, the way that these bacteria cause disease is first you breathe them, so they're inhaled into the lungs, and then they're phagocytosed by macrophages in the alveoli of the lungs. Mycobacterium have evolved very elaborate ways to successfully survive in a macrophage, which is a terrible thing for us because a macrophage is meant to kill microbes. And so the way they've done that is the mycolic acids of their cell wall stop the fusion of the phagosome with the lysosome. Remember, when a macrophage takes a bug in, it puts it in a phagosome, and then a lysosome, which has all the digestive enzymes, has to fuse with that phagosome. Well, if you never get the lysosome to fuse with the phagosome, you won't die because there's no digestive enzymes. And the mycolic acids also stimulate an inflammatory response on our end. Then you get all this inflammation, and the organisms are isolated from the inflammation in a little spot, a granular spot that we call a tubercle. These tubercles eventually heal and they become calcified, which are called Gones complexes, if any of you guys are reading about this. The tubercle over time can break down and release bacteria, and then the bacteria can go and infect more cells in the lungs, in cardiovascular system, lymphatic system. This is if TB has gotten very bad. Again, to continue on with pathogenesis, initial infection by Mycobacterium tuberculosis results in asymptomatic lung infections to begin with, because the immune system usually will be able to control it, but unable to eliminate all the bugs. So you get a latent TB infection, which can at any point, or maybe never, turn into an active tuberculosis infection. Active tuberculosis infection is basically when you have tuberculosis. And if you get an infection that's spread, that's what we call miliary tuberculosis. And this is life-threatening. So keep that in mind. So this is the pathogenesis of TB. Signs and symptoms that someone has tuberculosis is that there is basically blood in their saliva. So they have a very hard time they have a hard time breathing, and coughs are very, when tuberculosis has spread, you can see blood in coughs. So just keep that in mind. And then again, here's a good image that differentiates latent tuberculosis from active tuberculosis. Active tuberculosis is when we say someone has TB disease. With latent, they do have the bacteria in there, but it's not growing in the body. They are not spreading it to other people, but it can advance to active TB in that patient. So any one of us can have a latent TB. It does not mean that you're spreading it to other people, but just know inside of you, it can progress into an active tuberculosis infection. And when it is a tuberculosis disease, you can spread it to other patients. Diagnosis is we have the PPD test, which is a TB test. A lot of you have done that because I know a lot of you guys have volunteer in hospitals where you do have to have a TB test, and different careers. With this is when they inject, it's a tuberculin skin test, and they inject a little protein from the bacteria inside of you. They're not actually putting Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and they wait to see if you have a reaction to it. If you do, then you potentially could have TB, but it could also be latent infection. And if you suspect someone actually does have an active TB, you can do an x-ray or CT scan. You can do, you just look at their lungs to see if you're seeing these shadows. You can take a sample of the sputum and do an acid fast stain to see if you see the bacteria and culture the bacteria, though I wouldn't recommend this because it takes a very long time. And then there's a new rapid blood test that looks for interferon gamma, which are different types of cytokines that are produced in response to this bacteria. There's PCR tests, so a lot of different tests, but TB tests and x-rays are usually the way to go. Treatment, if someone does have TB, they usually will get a combination therapy with different antibiotics, and you are taking the drugs for at least 6 months because the bacteria are very slow to grow. Like I said, they take 16 hours to go from 1 to 2 bugs, and they may be dormant. And just to remind you guys, we right now these days we have a lot of spread of multi-drug resistant strains, which are resistant to our first line of antibiotic drugs, and even worse, extensively drug resistant Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which are resistant to all of our second line drugs. So these are very hard to treat, and there's newer, I want to say there's newer drugs in development, but it is very slow. Prevention is to very hard because there, I don't think there's very good research being done with TB for many reasons. Just know that there is a vaccine called the BCG vaccine. It's used in many countries, but it's not used in the US because it leads to a positive tuberculin test. I know a lot of people in class were born in other countries where you do take the BCG vaccine. So a lot of times when they do, like if you were born in another country, I've had students, like, for example, in Philippines is a good example of a country, various other countries, you get the BCG vaccine and then you come here and you're going to volunteer in a hospital and you do the TB test and it could potentially show positive because of that vaccine. And with this vaccine, the US is also worried about it because it's a live attenuated vaccine. It is not very safe in immunocompromised patients. So again, this is why it's not given here in the US. And there's vaccines being developed and improving living standards. Like we once had a high spread of tuberculosis in San Francisco because of the very bad poverty conditions in San Francisco. Possible complications, mainly lung damage. So if the TB is not treated, it can lead to lung damage and it can spread to other organs and cause death. It is the leading cause of death for people with HIV, like I talked about in the beginning, with AIDS. And 9 million people develop TB annually, 2 million people die. So it is a very serious condition that we have in the world right now. To summarize tuberculosis, again, the symptoms are cough and sputum, sputum that has blood in it. Incubation period, it takes a really long time to see symptoms. It can take months to see symptoms. It's caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which is an acid fast rod. And these bacteria colonize the alveoli and they get phagocytosed, but they can live in the macrophage. The epidemiology is it's spread by inhalation, and treatment and prevention to treat it, you can take antibiotics. Prevention is just, there is the BCG vaccine. We do not take it here, but prevention, I would say, is to better living standards so that people are not infecting each other if they are infected. The next lower respiratory tract infection is influenza. Influenza, a lot of us have already had influenza or the flu. Influenza is a disease, a lower respiratory tract infection that's caused by the influenza virus. And we're going to talk about something, antigenic changes. But antigenic changes, basically when the virus changes, are responsible for serious annual epidemics, and they infect approximately 20% of humans every single year. So it is very prevalent, influenza. There is 3 major virus types based on the protein coat or the capsid, but type A influenza virus causes the most serious disease. So that's the one we're going to talk about. And I want everyone to keep in mind that influenza viruses have nothing to do with the stomach flu. Stomach flu is something completely different. Influenza viruses causes influenza or the flu. When we look at this, the flu is caused by the influenza A virus, and it is an RNA virus, so we see 8 pieces of RNA in the virus. It is an enveloped virus, so just like SARS-CoV-2, there's an envelope outside the capsid. Remember when we learned about viruses? There are spikes called hemagglutinin spikes or HA spikes, and these are the spikes that the virus uses to recognize and attach to our cells. And then there are other spikes called NA spikes and or neuraminidase spikes. And these are the spikes that help the virus leave the infected cells so that they can go on to infect more cells. Different subtypes, if you hear about like H5N1 and all these things, they have to do with these spikes. With HA and NA spikes. Again, the HA spikes is to enter our cells, the NA spike is to leave. And if you, anyone has heard about the avian flu H5N1, it was, all of these are basically from birds, 2009 swine flu H1N1. So these are different subtypes of the spikes. With the influenza, it is seasonal. Only a small percentage of cases are fatal or deadly, but there are so many cases, so the overall death is high because it's so common. Most death, if you do hear of someone who's passed away from influenza, it's usually due to a secondary bacterial infection. For example, pneumonia. Pneumonia is common. If you are like 90 years old and you get influenza, it may lead to pneumonia. So that's where we see fatal cases. Epidemics happen annually. Pandemics are rare with influenza, and all known influenza A viruses are found in birds. So keep that in mind. It did originate in birds. And in 1997, so Hong Kong, H5N1 virus from chickens spread to humans. So it was in chickens and it spread to humans. So it did start off zoonotic. And then the H7N9 avian virus appeared in China in 2013. So if you were keeping up with that story in 2013, that was from China and it was from birds, but we... Actually, I don't want to talk about it more. So we'll talk about antigenic drift and antigenic shift. So there's something called antigenic drift and antigenic shift, and it looks like I accidentally deleted that slide when I was preparing this, but I'll discuss it. Antigenic drift are small mutations that happen to the virus, and these small mutations lead to different seasonal influenza. So you have a little bit of a mutation happen to the virus, and then it leads to a difference between last season's flu versus this season's flu. So that's antigenic drift. Antigenic shift is when you have the virus change so much that it can almost jump species. So from birds to pigs to humans, it mutated so much that now for example, if you had it infecting a bird, it will only infect bird cells, but it mutates so much that now it can attach to human cell receptors, and that's antigenic shifts, and that's when we see pandemics with this one. So again, small mutations are antigenic drifts, and they lead to seasonal influenza. Antigenic shifts are when the virus mutates so much or gains so many different mutations that it can lead to pandemics because they're completely new viruses that our body is not immune to yet. So with antigenic drift, your immune system may recognize it a little bit. With antigenic shift, we have no immunity. It's completely new. So this is what leads to pandemics, similar to what we're seeing with COVID-19 right now. You see a lot of assortments with the virus. So the RNA segments assort so much that you see an antigenic shift. So for example, if you have the virus and it infects the bird, maybe it's transmitted to the pig, and then in the pig, it gets mutated and now it can infect the human, and in the human, you see more mutations. So you get more infections from human to human. You can also see more mixtures of RNA segments from different organisms. So this is what leads to mutations and so many different influenza strains. Pathogenesis of this is you get the flu, you guys know this, by inhaling it from someone who's infected, and then it's carried to the lungs. The HA spikes on the virus help it attach to your epithelial cells, and then the virus is in the cells, it makes copies of itself like all viruses, and then it leaves your cells by its NA spikes. Our infected cells ultimately die, and it takes a really long time for those cells that were ciliated to remake themselves. And so the mucociliary escalator is really affected for many weeks as you have this viral infection. So you can easily get secondary infections from bacteria, fungus, anything else. The virus then exits with coughing and infects other people. So I want you guys to take the take-home message is our infected cells die, they slough off or come off, and our mucociliary escalator is destroyed by influenza virus. The immune system quickly can control the influenza virus in most people, and we see complete recovery in a few weeks. Signs and symptoms of a flu are, main one is fever and chills. So chills and fever go hand in hand. Headache, muscle aches, sore throat, and usually acute symptoms last for about 1 week. So the main difference between, I would say, a cold and a flu is that with a flu, you do see fever and you see muscle aches. Treatment, it's usually self-limiting. You don't do anything. It limits itself. Your immune system fights it off. But we do have antiviral medications that are not very effective. These are the same medications, by the way, that they're testing right now with SARS-CoV-2 for COVID-19. We have NA inhibitors. And remember, the virus needs one spike to get into our cells and the other spike to leave. The spike it uses to leave your cells to infect other cells is a neuraminidase spike. So if you've heard of Tamiflu or Relenza, they're NA inhibitors, but they're not that effective because by the time, usually when someone has a flu, if they do even consider going to the doctor, it's because it's gone really bad. So by the time it's spread so much, these drugs don't work. These drugs only work in the beginning of the influenza infection. And at that point, usually people are not even getting checked for it. Prevention, there are trivalent and quadrivalent vaccines. Basically, vaccines where scientists choose the most common 3 or 4 strains in circulation and then create a vaccine. It takes the vaccine about a year to be created, I would say 9 months. So the vaccine that is this year predicted, it looked at last year's most common strains. They're very labor intensive and they don't provide long-term immunity. So people keep taking a vaccine every year because new strains are always coming out because of all the antigenic drift. And they're about 70 to 90% effective. And then finally, influenza can cause possible complications. It can lead to secondary bacterial infections that can lead to pneumonia. We do see death from influenza even in healthy people. So we do see about 10 to 40,000 deaths per year in the US. It has 1% mortality. Mortality is death rate. So usually the very young and the very old in societies are highly affected by influenza. So to summarize it, signs and symptoms are influenza, are fever and muscle aches, mainly with all the other things that you guys already know. Incubation period, 1 to 2 days. It's caused by the influenza virus, which is an enveloped RNA virus. It infects respiratory epithelial cells, and epidemiology, antigenic drift and antigenic shift happens so much with the virus that it's hard to create an effective antiviral drug or vaccine because it's drifting and shifting. It's drifting so much more than shifting. Treatment is self-limiting. There really isn't a treatment. There aren't antiviral drugs. They're not that effective. Prevention, there is vaccines developed and given annually. Finally, our last lower respiratory tract infection, which I added last minute to this lecture, so previous years have not learned this, is about COVID-19. COVID-19 is a lower respiratory system infection. It does affect the lungs, but we're going to also talk about SARS and MERS. So SARS, MERS, and COVID-19 are 3 coronaviruses that cause new diseases. They're new coronaviruses. With SARS, it stands for severe acute respiratory syndrome. That's the disease. And SARS was seen in 2003. It had to do with 27 countries and resulted in 8,000 cases and 800 deaths. No new cases have been reported since 2004. MERS, or the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, was seen in 2012, more recently, and involved more than 25 countries. By 2016, there were 18,000 cases and 600 deaths. Now we jump to our third novel severe coronavirus. coronavirus disease, COVID-19, was seen in 2019, so at the end of last year, and it involves over 200 countries. And as of now, as of today, May 2020, we see over 4 million infected cases and around 300,000 deaths worldwide. So this is a reminder that a disease can emerge in one part of the world and quickly spread everywhere. And these are all SARS, MERS, and COVID-19 are all diseases that are caused by viruses, novel coronaviruses that have mutated so much to cause such severe infections. Signs and symptoms, with all of them, SARS, MERS, and COVID-19, you see typical flu-like symptoms, fever, muscle aches, cough, and the incubation period is 2 to 7 days. So with COVID-19, it's about 5 days. You can develop pneumonia. These are the severe cases. The etiology, the SARS is caused by the coronavirus SARS-CoV. MERS is caused by the coronavirus MERS-CoV. COVID-19 is caused by the coronavirus SARS-CoV-2. Now, if you look, SARS-CoV-2 and SARS-CoV have the same name, basically, minus the two. The reason why we called the virus that causes COVID-19 SARS-CoV-2 is because it's most similar to the SARS-CoV virus that caused the SARS disease, but they're three different viruses, and all of them are enveloped RNA viruses that have spikes on them. Pathogenesis, these viruses, three different coronaviruses infect cells in the lower respiratory tract, and they damage cells there, inciting a very strong immune response, lots of inflammation, and it's the inflammation and all the cytokines that's damaging tissue and damaging the host, us. Epidemiology, there's zoonotic viruses. They likely originated in bats. So when you look at the sequence of the RNA sequence of these viruses, it's very similar to sequences of coronaviruses from bats. They're transmitted, you guys all know this by now, they're transmitted by droplets, close person-to-person contact, and some are super spreaders like we see with SARS-CoV-2, which causes COVID-19. Treatment and prevention, unfortunately, there is no treatment as of right now, but what we can do is we can have preventative care. So there's mechanical, not preventative care, I forgot what the word is. It's basically the care you do when someone is sick, just to make relief care, something like that. So we have mechanical ventilators that we give for people who are struggling with breathing because of all the inflammation that happens in their lungs. There are experimental medications for severe cases, but the key word here is experimental. So right now with COVID-19, they're retesting all the medications they were making with MERS and SARS and the vaccines. Typical prevention methods are to wash hands, avoid crowds, wear face masks, everything you're doing, disinfect surfaces. And there's a lot of research right now, a lot, to try to develop vaccines, because as of right now, we don't have a vaccine for any of these. And vaccine creation stopped for SARS and MERS because they kind of just stopped. So right now we're looking at old research that was done with these two to see if we can use them with COVID-19. To summarize, these three novel coronaviruses, they cause fever, coughs, muscle aches. The incubation period is 2 to 5 days. The causative agent or etiology, SARS is caused by the SARS-CoV virus. MERS is caused by the MERS-CoV virus. COVID-19 is caused by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. The pathogenesis is they damage alveoli in the lung. They can lead to pneumonia. They lead to inflammation. Epidemiology, they're zoonotic viruses that probably were started off in bats, spread through respiratory droplets. And treatment and prevention, I found the word I was looking for, supportive care. Supportive care, such as ventilators and IV prevention, we have no vaccine right now. So to summarize, we learned about the respiratory tract infections, and we talked about upper respiratory tract infections and lower respiratory tract infections. We learned about strep throat, which is caused by bacteria, common colds, which are caused by viruses, pneumonia, which can be caused by bacteria, viruses, fungus, tuberculosis, which is caused by mycobacterium bacteria, influenza, which is caused by a virus, and three novel coronaviruses, SARS, MERS, and COVID-19. So these are the respiratory tract infections that we talked about.